Where'd he get that young man from then, huh?
From a stork?
He already had a date. So the show opened up with the orchestra and then the reveal of God of War. Yeah.
Which is, I mean, for just seeing Kratos on screen was enough, I think, enough excitement for most PlayStation fans. But to see how that demo angled in a completely different direction for the franchise was incredibly exciting.
Was funny that the Marcus Fenix reveal from earlier in the day is like, exactly. It's like, it's literally him poking his head out from the shadows, and you see that he's a beard and that he's older.
Yeah. It wouldn't be AAA video games without white guys with scruffy old beards.
I mean, it's just funny to me because GOW as the abbreviation has confused me for years. Like,
I know.
In acronyms.
That's really
so
funny.
It's like,
I didn't think about that.
Yeah, yeah. So it's like those two games of all games being that summer.
Dad's back and he's hiding in the darkness again.
But no, the God of War demo was definitely stunning. And Marty wrote a preview that's very good.
I remember IGN's most trafficked preview of E3 2016.
What was it? Was that the one that said it made us care about God of War? Yeah, I saw a lot of negative reception on that.
It was super mixed.
The best preview of all time?
No, it was a fantastic preview, but people's gut reaction was, what do you mean you didn't like it before? And it's like, well, because we didn't. Would you guys win a bet?
Why are you throwing? No, I just gave Marty $5. I'm always asking for money for Red Bulls, but also I figured it's a good time. Congratulations on your preview. You get $5.
Thank you so much.
Wow. Yeah. The annual max.
Yeah, I mean, we've talked about it on the show.
Like, that's a trust.
Yeah. I'm going to write another really good preview. Okay. We talked on the show how we've all played God of War, but we sort of had mixed feelings about it. I think it was a thing that was very much at a certain place and a certain time it worked. Old God of War worked on the PS2. It worked in the mid-2000s. Like, it worked in that era of games and era of, like, just American society as a whole and storytelling in the medium.
Sure.
But 10 years later, when we have things like The Walking Dead and we have things like The Last of Us, and people expect a little bit more. And it doesn't mean, like, oh, they're making Kratos a pussy and he's not going to kill anything. I'm like, no, you can have both of them. You can have an amazing, violent, mechanically rich action game where you also actually care about the story, and it's not about a dude throwing a woman into a cauldron so that you could proceed through a door.
Yeah, and I mean, I'm making fun of your preview. The preview actually is really good. Yeah. Corey Balrog, director. Had this
Barlog.
Thank you, God. I do that every time. I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry, Corey. He had this incredible quote where he said, "We already made a game about the Hulk. Now we're making a game about Bruce Banner."
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
and that nails it. That is such a powerful quote and such a powerful example of how you can kind of this isn't a reboot and
no,
it isn't
it's a continuation
ignoring what
of
happened before.
Story.
Yeah, yeah. It's almost like the hyper violence and all the in his past, like. You couldn't do this game without it. You need to know how awful he was
it's
and
like
what happened.
I say with every sort of like reboot or anything like that is it very rarely retroactively deletes the previous iterations of that story, right? Like if you like the old God of Wars, you can go back and play them. Like it sucks that you can't really do that on PS4.
Yeah.
But I'm hoping that gets made available in some capacity. But those games are still there and you can still play them. I think this is not changing the character. It's actually enriching the character.
Yes.
Like
100%.
To me, it's not like removing traits from him that you love or you enjoy. It's giving you more backstory and it's giving you more personality and it's giving you more history and lineage.
And consequence.
And consequence.
He's learning from what he did, which is something you never, like in a video game, like we joke about Uncharted all the time, right? Yeah. Where it's like Nathan Drake, awesome character. I really love him. I care about him. I care about his story. But he's walking around killing all these people and it's something that's never really addressed. And like the idea of years later, like because Kratos is immortal. This could be sent 500 years later. We don't know.
Right.
Like it's so exciting to see somebody being like, okay, like there are 7 games in this franchise.
Yeah.
Like what would those do to a person? And what would he be like when he did decide to settle down?
They have a deep connection and passion to the source material here. Like when I interviewed Corey on our live show and both on and off camera, I was sort of just like, were you worried about the reception for this? Because like the gut reaction to things changing at all in almost any facet of entertainment media now is venomous vitriol. Just horrible.
If that is something, dear listeners, that you find yourself doing, stop for a moment and realize that we wouldn't have Christopher Nolan's Batman movies if somebody hadn't decided to move past like the Adam West Super Friends age. You know, like media has to grow.
Or stopped at Joel Schumacher Batman.
Or any of your favorite comics. Yeah. They would all just be golden age forever.
I think they were
looking
at like the Call of Duty trailer and the Girl Ghostbusters trailer. And they're like, oh, we're going to be the next ones. People are going to hate what we're doing with this thing. And that's not the case. I think there's been a very slight outcry about this. But for most people, I think, like I've said before, just go back and play the old ones. They're still there.
Yeah. So well, and he's also said, they've said, like, hey, this game's going to be filled with crazy, huge set pieces where you're climbing monsters. But they didn't want to show that because, like, we're the dudes who made all the God of War games. We know how to do that. Trust us. Yeah. We're going to do that. So we want to show you something different.
Like, we hate elephants. We want to kill them.
It's still going to be violent and visceral. Like, you saw that in the trailer.
Things tusk off. And,
people were pulling out all the hidden gods in that trailer.
Oh, you think like Loki might be in the background?
Yeah, there's so much stuff.
The Midgar Serpent. Yeah, there's a lot of really cool stuff.
I talked to him about sort of that, the kind of like Tomb Raider approach of making these kind of open world environments that funnel into more story driven kind of like hallways and then back into like fields and stuff like that. I think that's fascinating. Yeah, I think that's a really cool way to tell a story. And you guys were talking about how that game doesn't break, right?
There's no cut.
It begins. So what we saw is, they said it's the beginning of the game, although the beginning of the game is going to be handled a little bit differently. Like, this is the beginning of the game that they tried to compact into a 10-minute story for the demo. So the game is going to sort of start where you, I think, the kid going in and seeing Kratos, and the game will never cut from beginning to end. So you imagine it's going to be one continuous, whatever, 10-hour journey.
Will the game start with the kid's mother dying? Because it's heavily implied in the trailer.
Oh, no. The whole game is about who is the kid's. Yeah. They're not naming the kid, or they're not saying who the mother is, because I think it's some important thing. One of my theories was that Thor, or the kid is Thor, and that Kratos is Odin.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
And, God, that's so cool.
Yeah, I think there's going to be some major really, and like, they're really smart about how they're layering in mythology, because I don't think, like, those games kind of beat you over the head with it, but I get the impression this one's going to be a little bit more subtle. And even like, we saw the BCD, and they were like, yeah, like, if you look closely as you're going through this area, like, if you watch that demo, because the BCD was just the E3 demo that we saw, but a little more extended.
They were meandering a bit.
And they point out that, like, there's a point where you fight the troll. It's like the big action set piece. If you look, there's like sort of a backstory that's told totally through environmental stuff there, where as you're going, there's evidence that there was a fight, and there's evidence that basically there were men who had captured these trolls and were stringing them up and torturing them and killing them.
And that's why the troll only has one tusk when you come by him. He's already beaten up.
Yeah. If you go back into the woods, you can see there's like all these like trees that are knocked down, and there's like corpses and blood, because one of the trolls essentially escaped and wiped out all the men. And by the time you get to the later area, he's like waiting and looking to clean up if there's anyone left.
Yeah. Wow.
Yep.
Damn. Can't wait.
Yep.
Yeah. My only like shortcoming about this is after Skyrim and The Witcher, like, I feel like the whole kind of Norse environment, it's going to be hard to impress me with it, you know, just because I've seen so much of it. There was a rumor that they were considering doing ancient Egypt for a second, which I really hope we get at some point.
Yeah, I mean, that's the rumor for the next AC. So it's like you might scratch that itch a little bit.
I just want to fight a man with a dog's head.
Yeah.
Anubis.
Anubis.
Oh, you can fight Anubis in Spelunky, available on PSN.
Shut up.
Totally.
All right.